Okay, guys, we had that PowerPoint last time that we went over trade. Remember, we also went over how, this is a continuation of what happened with the Mongols, and we know new things are being introduced because of the Mongols. Trade is being secured. We see that new ideas such as gunpowder, rice, sugar are being traded. We talked about the plague and how the Mongols kind of facilitated the transferring of that. And so now what we're going to look at is the Ming Dynasty. We see that the Yuan Dynasty is finally out, and in China, and the new dynasty is rising up to recover the economy. When Emperor Hong Wu is an orphan that rises through the monastery system, and he rises up and he makes his way through the military, and he's going to overthrow the Yuan Dynasty, which we know that's the Mongol Dynasty. And he's going to eliminate everything Mongol out of China. He's going to go back to Confucian educational system and the civil service exam that we're going to get, create a central government bureaucracy that is strong with educated people. And so the Ming Dynasty is going to focus on educating people, and this is what's going to be called the Mandarins. It's a special class of powerful officials that are educated through the Confucian system that are going to implement imperial policy. The eunuchs, however, are people who are also part of this official class, but they're government service people, and they cannot marry. And many people feel that the eunuchs will never try to dethrone whoever's in power because they cannot generate families. And we see that they do advance when they have good favor of the emperor. So one of the things that will happen is the economy will recover. We will see that porcelain, silk, fine textiles, cotton textiles will be traded out of China. And we will see the Chinese government increase domestic trade by gaining control of who's coming in and who's coming in out of China. And we see they also create paper money in this area, which will force many of the Europeans and the Middle Eastern people to trade their gold and silver for paper money. And we see a cultural revival. The Yongle Encyclopedia is created, just charting the traditions of the Chinese people. The Mings are going to sponsor naval exploration. And we're going to see these expeditions will go out into the Indian Ocean basin. They will cover control foreign trade with China, basically who's allowed in and who's not allowed in. They also control what is going on with the money, turning in that gold for paper money. And we see that foreign people have to have favor of the Ming Dynasty. Zheng He will lead expeditions of people into the Indian Ocean basin. And he will develop relations with the foreign nations, and he will basically get favor with those nations by giving silk and porcelain gifts to the emperors or people in control. And we see that eventually Zheng He's expeditions will end by the mid-1430s because instead of investing money in exploration, which we'll see many imperial governments will invest in exploration, they need to focus on keeping their borders safe because of external pressures and focus on agriculture. So as the Ming Dynasty recovers, they're gonna build a new base nation state, and we're gonna see they're gonna levy taxes on his citizens. It will come directly to the king, and he's gonna be able to finance his standing army and internal improvements. We're gonna see the standing armies will be trained soldiers. They will use gunpowder, and they're gonna be paid by the state. Competition between Europeans is going to intensify, and so this is why China is going to gain control of putting more money into controlling trade, having wars to make sure it's maintaining its strength. And we're going to see it's going to improve its naval technology. We know that they've done stuff such as the creation of the compass, but they're going to develop stronger ships, landing sails. Just knowing that it invests in its navy, that it will be powerful. The last thing we need to talk about is the Renaissance, this rebirth of culture. We're going to see the Renaissance is the French word for rebirth. It's going to be a revival of learning and art and architecture. And we see that they're going to develop a sophisticated society in Western Europe. A lot of their influence comes from the Greek and the Romans, revitalizing the painting, the sculpting, the architecture, also revitalizing that whole idea about observation, looking within. And so we're going to see the Renaissance. We're going to see all of, I know it says hint, know your Ninja Turtles, but we know our Ninja Turtles developed from our Renaissance artists. But Leonardo, he's going to be famous for focusing on bone structure, muscle structure, and we're going to see this in his two paintings, the Mona Lisa and the Last Supper. You will have to know these for your test. We're going to see a lot of his stuff will focus on the bone and muscle structure. So here's Mona Lisa, again, focusing on bone structure. And then the Last Supper, focusing on like movement in the art. Michelangelo, we know him with the Sistine Chapel, and he's basically does all of the creation story of the biblical story in St. Peter's Cathedral. So here's just the cathedral top. Raphael is gonna focus on classical styles and Christian styles. And so this is the School of Athens, where he is including the ideas of Roman and Greek architecture, revitalizing that back into the Renaissance. And Donatello, he's our sculptor, and he does the David. So that's easy to remember, Donatello with the David, D&D. Sorry, it had to be censored. The other thing in Renaissance is the revitalization of architecture. The last time we saw a dome was with Sophia Hagia. It used to be an Eastern Orthodox church, and then we know it's a Muslim church today. That was the last time we saw a dome. But the Brunelleschi dome, we're going to see, is going to create as the Cathedral of Florence. And it's just modeled after the Pantheon Temple in Rome, but also from what we've seen of Hagia Sophia. Okay, also at this time, we get a group of people called the Humanists. These are like scholars and literary figures that are interested in study of literature and art and philosophy. Again, this is the invoking of what we saw in Greece and Rome with looking deeper in. And so we're going to see that they're deeply committed to Christianity and invoking that Christianity idea through the study of literature, history, and philosophy. We get the New Greek Testament created by Roger Dahm, and we see that we get the polishing of Greek and Roman authors in new languages. Okay, so we're going to see the humanist, again, I've talked about this, that they're combining Christian values with ethics, the ideas of what we've seen from the Greek and Romans. And we're going to see people could still, what they're going to express is that Christians can still enjoy a social life while maintaining their Christian beliefs. Now we're going to look at exploration. We know exploration will eventually have a connotation of spreading Christianity, but Portugal is going to be the main nation that's going to lead exploration. One of the main reasons why is they feel that they're so far in the West that they feel that they're being undercut by those Eastern middlemen, that they're overcharging them for items that if they were able to get to India, if they were able to get to Asia, that they could bring back cheaper. And so we're going to see Portugal is going to lead the Atlantic exploration. They're going to figure out if we could come down Africa, go around Africa and get to India, we could possibly bring back goods at a lesser cost. And that's the key thing. They're upset at that Middle Eastern middleman, that Muslim middleman that is overcharging them. And so we see Prince Henry the Navigator wants to spread Christianity. I told you that overtone. That was one of the things with exploration and Portuguese influence on the seas. And so what's going to happen is they're going to come down the coast of Africa and they're going to start these trade port cities or dysphoric communities where they're basically coming in and gaining a port so that they can move down to the next port. And so what's gonna happen is they're gonna start trading in Africa. They're gonna trade manufactured goods for African golden slaves. And they need that gold to be able to trade for stuff in India and China. Bartolomeu Dias will be the first guy to actually get to the bottom part of Africa called the Cape of Good Hope. And by getting here, he's able to track the coast of Africa and the appropriate currents that they need to take to be able to get here. Bartolomeu Dias will set the path for Vasco da Gama to get to Calcutta, India. Our last guy is actually, he's a Spaniard who is not a Spaniard. He goes to the Spanish government. He's an Italian explorer trying to figure out an easier way, since the Portuguese have already gotten through Africa. Could they sail west to get to Asia and India? What's going to happen is he actually predicts that the world is a little bit smaller, that our Earth is a little bit smaller, and he lands in the Bahamas thinking he lands in India. And he realizes these places that are rich in resources, there's nothing here. And so he basically paved the way for Caribbean exploration in the Americas, which we'll talk about later. And I think we are done. Okay, guys, that was easy. Make sure you finish your study guide. If you're going to be gone on Friday, make sure you get a review quiz for Miss Morgan. And make sure you're looking for the answers that will be posted online.